creatures of our God and King. Lift up your voice and let us sing. Oh, praise Him. Hallelujah. The burning sun with golden beam.
What if you could have a conversation with the nation, maybe even the world's leading theologian, and you could ask them any question you wanted to be able to ask them about who God is, the nature of the Holy Spirit, things that Christ said, you'd take it, wouldn't you? But the great thing about this Sunday's conversation with Dr. Wacker is we get to give away the secret, and there are never any secrets about any of these conversations or anything that we have to tell you about Jesus. But we get to ask Dr. Wacker, what are Christians known for? And that question and the answer that he gives, it's a sacred moment and part of a conversation with someone who knows the Protestant church, who knows the history of Christianity, and has experienced who God is outside of an academic setting, outside of a classroom. I'm excited that you're able to be with us this Sunday for an extraordinary conversation with somebody who's just decided to follow Jesus. And even though they're a little e evangelical, understands the magnificence and the glory that it is to live out our faith. Welcome to White Plains.
Gathered to welcome someone into our fellowship. This is Carolyn Hendricks. First of all, who are these folks you've got with us today?
These are my parents, Betty Klutz and Frank Klutz, and they've been involved with the church for 30 years, a long time.
A long time.
And they've been part of White Plains or come back to White Plains.
She actually was on staff.
Yeah. Betty, you were on staff when I was hired.
As the youth director,
Betty was in the office in the event. So we had a little bit of crossover time. Mm-hmm.
And she said it was downhill after that.
I know. That was the final straw.
We're still trying to recover, yeah. Betty.
But Carolyn, we're here to welcome you into fellowship here at White Plains. And apart from obviously joining in with your family here, but you've talked to me about another concern that you have, passion that you have.
So I am involved with an organization called The Caring Place. I actually am one of the leaders there of that organization. And we help working homeless families with children. And if you think about our environment right now, it is a tremendous environment of need in that space. And we provide transitional housing for those families for 16 weeks. And while they're in that housing, they don't pay rent or utilities, but they work with a support team. Mm-hmm. On average, they save about $3,000 while mm-hmm. they're in the program. Beyond that, we have a one-year program mm-hmm. that we help elevate their situation. So the transitional housing program stabilizes them, mm-hmm. gets them housed. And then the one-year program helps to get them better jobs. Or we have one family that's gone from homelessness to home ownership.
Wow.
After being homeless for 9 years.
Oh.
And so it's a passion of mine, and it goes back to my roots, to my, mm-hmm. my mom, who raised four children on $90 a week. And it's that grit and determination that I see in these families. They're not looking for us to save them. They mm-hmm. just need direction and a partner to walk with them.
And you've roped in the help team some now, have you not?
I am working on them.
Good.
Outstanding. Good. So you never know. We might be in touch with you to get involved in this ministry or one of the many others that we support here. Mm-hmm. But today, we are here to welcome you to fellowship, and we have a question for you.
Carolyn, just one question for you. Since you come from United Methodist Church, and that's been your history and tradition, as a member of this congregation, will you faithfully participate in its ministries, White Plains Ministry, by your prayers, your presence, your gifts, your service, and your witness? If you will you say, I will?
I will.
Then, hey, guess what? We're excited you to do so.
Yes,
not
we are.
Absolutely. We do promise to you that we will work together, that we all are increasing faith, that we're encouraging each other in hope, and that we're all of us making God's love real personally and as a group. And now I invite us to make that promise formally together. So let's join together so Carolyn knows of our love and support. We give thanks for all that God has already given you. And we welcome you in Christian love as members together with you in the body of Christ and in this congregation of the United Methodist Church. We renew our covenant faithfully to participate in the ministries of the church by our prayers, our presence, our gifts, our service, and our witness, that in everything God may be glorified through Jesus Christ.
Lord, we give you thanks for Carolyn and for her many years of service, for what she does every day to make your love real and to build your kingdom here on earth. Lord, we thank you for this congregation and the many, many opportunities that are provided here for folks to engage in your kingdom building work. But Lord, move us all to a greater place of openness, to look at others as you see them, and to break down walls and stereotypes so that your justice and your will and your work can be done right here on earth, right here in Cary, just as it is in heaven. Amen.
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 Sets you apart, oh grateful heart.
your thought, what you do and say. We are called to become one, a new work has begun. Above all, be clothed in love, which binds everything in perfect harmony. Unity in non-essentials, diversity in all things, love will be done. Spirit of peace, make us one. Above all, be clothed in love, which binds everything in perfect harmony.
Worship today. I'm Ray, one of the pastors at White Plains. We continue this series of conversations where we're talking about Christian leaders, thinkers, lay people, clergy, people who spend their lives in academics. And many years ago, I was a pastor of a church that was close to Duke University, and I had the privilege of pastoring some of the Duke faculty, which is a wonderful gift to me. One of the ones who has become a cherished friend is a historian, a Christian historian, and taught it for all of you Carolina fans, both at Carolina and Duke. So you get both today.
Yeah.
This is Dr. Grant Wacker. Hey, Grant.
Hello.
And so he is a dear friend. He and his wife, Catherine. They have two girls and three grandchildren.
Five grandchildren.
That's right. That's right. Five
Number
grandchildren.
Girls, yeah.
They keep growing.
Yeah.
And, two son-in-laws.
Yeah.
And so anyway, but Grant, we have arrived today at Apex United Methodist Church. Why?
I can't imagine.
I can't either.
No. Let me rack my brain on that one. Well, it's possible because my daughter is the lead pastor here, my daughter Laura.
Apex United Methodist Church. Yeah. So let's go on in. So
we're marching to Zion.
Marching to Zion.
Is that what we're doing?
Or
okay.
Apex, whichever way you want to call it.
Apex, whichever way. Is there a difference?
Yeah. Well, for Laura, I hope they're similar.
Yeah.
But you've two girls, both in the area, five grandchildren, all in the area.
Yeah.
wife, Catherine, who was spent her years in education as well.
She's a guidance counselor in Durham Public Schools.
In Durham Public Schools, where my wife went to school, Public Schools. Yeah.
Why don't we just for many, many years, and she retired happily a few years ago.
So, but Grant, you spent several years at UNC. First of all, we're going to go back, and then you spent several years at Duke and recently retired. But before we go to that, where did you grow up?
Well, my wife would say, insofar as I grew up. All right.
Insofar as you grew up.
That's right, yeah.
Well, she's probably right, but okay.
Yeah, we both grew up in a small town, southwest Missouri, in Springfield, Missouri. Now it's a big town.
Right.
But in those days, it's a very small town. Mm-hmm. And then we both went to school there, and I went off to California for college and to Boston for graduate school, and then my first job was at UNC, as you indicated.
Yeah.
And Catherine went to college in the same town we grew up in, and then she went into the Peace Corps in India. Mm-hmm. And there was this would have been in the late 60s, and in those days, there was an ad on television that would come on frequently, and it said, the world is filled with hunger, poverty, and disease. Join the Peace Corps and see what you can do about it.
Oh.
And that was gripping.
Yes.
And that gripped her.
Yeah.
And it gripped me, and I didn't have the courage to go in the Peace Corps. I mean, it takes courage to do this.
Yes, it certainly does.
And so she went to a tiny town in northwest India. And whatever I may have learned in graduate school, I think pales compared to what she learned in this little town and the intercultural experience and coming as a Christian. And then here she is face to face with a Hindu family and a Muslim family. And became very close to both of them.
Yeah. How long was she there?
2 years.
2 years?
Yeah.
Now, Grant, you also, you where did you go to undergrad?
Stanford.
Went to undergrad, Stanford.
California.
In California. Mm-hmm. And then came back east for graduate school at Boston?
No, Harvard.
Harvard.
Mm-hmm.
I had a Boston. Okay, that's right. Well, I was thinking
I said Boston.
That's
actually, Harvard's in Cambridge.
Cambridge, yes.
But it's just over the river.
Yeah.
Well, yeah.
What? I didn't remember that.
Yeah, that's could swim over there.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, all right.
And my first job was at UNC.
Yeah.
And I was there 15 years. Yeah. Well, at UNC, I taught in the Department of Religious Studies, which takes a totally secular approach to the study of religion.
Sure.
Mm-hmm. And I felt that was not where I could be who I was.
Mm.
And so a position came open at Duke Divinity School. Mm-hmm. And so that spoke to me in my calling. I'd much rather spend my time helping to train young men and women for ministry. And then there also was the option of helping to train doctoral students. And so for me, it was the best of all worlds.
Both worlds, worlds for you.
I was very happy. I loved it.
Yeah.
Loved it.
And I will also say, I don't want to embarrass him, but he came to Duke after I was gone. I had the unbelievable privilege of serving as pastor of the church he and Catherine went to. But also, knowing some of his students, Grant was an extremely popular teacher. And if you're ever with him, you soon find out. He knows more than I could ever imagine. Particularly, for me, it's not just history. You're an astute student of culture and what's going on around us. And he loves movies and theater, and he is just really on top of all of that. But you said something a while ago, talking about the Peace Corps, and that commercial was so gripping. What do you find gripping today?
Before I answer that, I'm going to have to say something about Ray Warren, and that is this. Maybe 20 years ago, my wife had open heart surgery at Duke. And she's fine now, but it was a morning surgery, and when we got there at 5:30 in the morning, Ray was there.
As I should have been, in my way of thinking.
Yeah.
We'll never forget that. Yeah. And I'm sure you've done it, what, thousands of times, you know, mm-hmm. but it's part of the pastoral calling. But I think we often forget how small measures, seemingly small measures like that, actually loom huge
yeah.
in the life of a
person. Well, when you're going through those times, yeah. they don't get much bigger than
heart
surgeries. Yeah, that's pretty major.
I mean, you know, there is a mortality percentage, yes. and yes. just the recognition and the fear and the anxiety,
yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
and to have your pastor there at that time of the day.
Yeah.
And Ray also was, and I know still is, a wonderful preacher. And so that's all part of your virtues, Ray. But it's that one incident that will be one of the ones that frame my ideal ministry. And I've told that story to my students. I taught in divinity school for 25 years, and I tell them that story because I want them to understand how much more there is to being a pastor than knowing the theology of it.
Yeah.
And if I can tell another quick story related to that event. I was teaching a seminar, and I had a doctoral student in that seminar who was Mormon, still mm. is.
Yeah.
But I scarcely knew him. He just came in, and I announced to class that I would miss class the next week because I knew my wife would be in surgery, and I just casually mentioned that and moved on. So the night of the surgery, I came home, and sitting on the doorstep was a casserole.
From your Mormon student.
And I opened it up, and it said, "We're praying for you, and we love you, Reed and Shelley Nielsen." I'd never met Shelley, his wife, at that point. So that night, I found his phone number, and I called him to thank him, and he said, "That's what we do."
That is gripping. When you talk about that was the question. I said, that is gripping when it was part of him.
Yes, yeah.
Part of who he was.
Yeah.
And I appreciate you saying those things about the hospital, but no buts, I appreciate it. And yet, isn't that what we do? Isn't that what we ought to be about?
Well, that's a great leading question, yeah. a springboard question for me. And there was a small town in Missouri, maybe 10 years ago, very, very small town, that had a town flag, all right? And I don't know, they had bears and tigers and whatever it was on the flag.
Yeah.
But down in the corner, in a little square, was a Christian cross, okay? Well, as you might imagine, the ACLU and others in the town objected, of course, yeah. and brought a lawsuit. And, you know, I'm sure 95% of the people in that town were Baptists. I mean, this is the kingdom of Baptists.
Baptist.
Okay, all right. But there's this little cross, and so somebody made a case of it. And it just occurred to me that, well, that cross represented violation of church and state separation, but at that time, it undoubtedly represented culture wars to them.
Mm.
The imposition of a culture war symbol mm-hmm. upon them, all mm-hmm. right? And I thought at the time, I mean, I teach Christian history, I thought at the time, what if that cross represented not culture war, but if it represented Pastor Warren coming to the hospital at 5:30 in the morning?
Mm.
What if that were the image, or what if the image was leaving a casserole on this step? I don't think there would have been the objection.
They would have been embracing, is what you're saying. If that's what that represented.
Yeah.
If people, whether they believed or not,
yeah.
they knew that meant those things.
Yeah. And it's the tithing of one's time that's involved there. And I don't know if it's 10%, but I'm saying, you know, well, we typically think of tithing as a financial contribution. And that's good. No way to disparage that
right.
whatsoever. But where I think Methodists are very good is historically and today is a recognition that the financial contribution is only part of what it means to be a Christian. It's the tithing of your time and the tithing of our commitment
yeah.
at the personal level. And it's who we are as people.
Right. Yeah, counts, who we are. But that makes a difference in people's lives.
Let me give you a new command. Love one another. In the same way I loved you, you love one another. This is how everyone will recognize that you're my disciples, when they see the love you have for each other. That's worth hearing again. This is how everyone will recognize that you're my disciples, when they see the love you have for each other. What do folks see when they see the way I love, or the way you love? Do they see me as one of Jesus' own?
We've gone from Apex United Methodist Church, where his daughter is lead pastor, and now we're over where he spent many years here at Duke. How many years were you here at Duke before retired?
25 years I taught.
25 years.
And I've been retired 5, but I continued to teach for a while after I retired. So
yes.
25 plus, we'll put it that way.
25 plus years he spent in these hallowed halls. Yeah. He, unfortunately for him, he never got to teach me as far as in these halls. He's taught me, but
it's heartbreaking.
In these halls.
It's heartbreaking.
Oh, I know. I can feel the pain.
Yeah, you can feel the pain.
Yeah, I can feel the pain. I mean, I came to this conversation undercover, trying to uncover some of this history and the lessons he's learned. But what I really got was some unexpected gems about really who and what we're called to be. And so I want to pick back up on that. He said, this is what we do.
Right.
Can you talk a minute about that as far as we as disciples, as Christian disciples, as followers? What did all that say to you? I mean, because to me, it speaks there's a bigger story there than those two individuals.
Right. That spoke to me at several levels. One is, he scarcely knew me. I scarcely knew him.
Oh, didn't know that.
He'd only been in my class for a few weeks, and it was a large class, and so it was not, you know, a close relationship. And that spoke to me that the generosity of heart was more than just an immediate relationship.
Right.
And what I've thought about since then is the way that phrase was formed. It is what we do. And by we, he meant an institution. And I thought that was telling, and I would ask to what extent our Christian faith and our evangelical and our Methodist faith has been, I would use the word, institutionalized. Now that word institutionalized is sometimes taken as a bad word. You know, we're not an institution. We're not an institution and all that. And I think actually institutions are a very good thing, because they guarantee continuity and they guarantee staying on track.
Also, there's an accountability.
Accountability, all of that, yes.
Yeah.
So I'm all in favor of, you know, occasionally I have students who talk about I'm spiritual but not religious, all right. Well, I'm an evangelical and upfront about this,
the correct word, evangelical.
Yeah. Small e.
Yes.
I grew up in this, and it's my tradition by adult choice.
Yes.
So I hold to it. Okay.
Yes.
I take responsibility for it. But having said that, I do think that evangelicals too often leave the question of character to a spur-of-the-moment development, or this something that I spontaneously do. And what we need to do is see it as a long-range training of character, because there are going to be times when we don't feel like doing it, and we need those deep roots.
But those deep roots call you to do it.
They do,
yes.
And I cherish, and I think it's all through our tradition, and certainly Wesley
was all about
structure, that
structure,
yes,
inculcation, nurture,
yes,
all of these words,
yes, because yeah, that's a forming, isn't it?
Forming. And I have a lot of connections now with Fuller Theological Seminary, and this is one of the fundamental words in their self-description, that their aim is to form especially young men and women, but not always men by any, and not always young by any means.
Right.
I mean, we have many mid-career and later career people, but on the whole, more young than not, and to form them in the ways of faith, in the ways of discipleship, so it stays for the long run.
Yeah. It's hard work. That's what Brent Strawn told us just the other day. Mm-hmm. He says, essentially what he said was, it is hard work. You know, he said, I'm a professor, and it's still hard work.
Yeah.
But we tend to have an aversion for that, it seems, to come spiritual life.
Right. Well, and I would say, even though Brent is Old Testament,
even though
he never saw the light and went into church history, in that case, he told the truth. He's also a very close friend, and I think the world of him.
He will love
him. Yeah, yeah, and he will have some words of retort.
Oh, I'm sure he will absolutely nail us somehow.
He won't say, you know, I never thought of that.
Yeah, no, he will not say that.
No, no.
He'll say, those two clowns, they don't know what they're talking
about. Yeah, that's right.
So,
but actually, I'm making a point, and that is that I think these goals come to us from multiple sources, from... Yeah. The Hebrew Bible, from the New Testament, from the history of the church.
Yes.
The tradition. Now, Wesley talked about tradition. I don't know if he talked about church history. Actually, he might have, but that doesn't come to me anyway.
Me either. Yeah, I've never thought about it.
Yeah, but, and actually, church history as a discipline doesn't actually arise until about a century ago.
But the traditions is probably what he was speaking into.
And what he's talking about was the wisdom of the centuries.
Yeah.
And actually, it's Pope John 23rd, who at one point, at Vatican too, he said, it's time for us to lift the windows and let the clean sea breeze of the centuries blow through.
Wow.
And I take that as an evangelical who is very sympathetic with the Roman Catholic tradition,
yes,
but I take that for my own faith, and that let's raise the windows, let the clean sea breeze of tradition inform us,
yes,
about where we've gone wrong,
yeah,
and how,
and to celebrate what we got right. We need
exactly
to do that more.
Exactly.
I mean, you know, both of those are parallel lines.
What has worked?
Yes. You know, a quick story about a friend of ours who has now gone on to glory. Ellen Kepley.
Mm.
Remember Ellen, one of the matriarchs of our church,
right,
that we are
right
a part of. Born and raised at Orange Church. Mm-hmm. And I'll never forget, did you and Catherine ever participate in the what do they call their autumn sale there?
Harvest Festival.
But they were known for, you mentioned those cakes, and they would sell and auction off these cakes. And also, some of them were auction off, some were just to feed people.
Right.
And we had a relative, they were getting all ready, and all these cakes were in the kitchen and in the fellowship hall. And one of our newer, younger folks had come in, young couple, and she had baked a couple of cakes. And one of the other people that was in the kitchen said, "Oh, honey, I don't think we need your cakes. I think we have enough." So you go, and I'll never forget Ellen Kepley. She was at the end of one of those long counters in the kitchen. She took her two cakes, swiped them in the garbage can. "We need them."
Right.
That's what you're saying.
Sure.
She said, "Oh no, we can use those cakes," and she dumped hers in the garbage can. I'll never forget it. Mm-hmm. Because she knew that young woman was more important than her cakes, that she probably, which were probably better.
Oh.
Knowing Ellen, I mean, they were probably better. She probably spent hours on them. Mm-hmm. But she knew that wasn't important.
Mm-hmm.
What was important was affirming that young woman and making room for her new church,
right,
and making her know that whatever she did was vitally important for us. Yeah, that's getting at that core of who we are. I hope you sensed why I like spending time with Grant Wacker and being with him and being friends with him. And as, I mean, he's such a real guy. Here is this, in the theological historical world, one of the greatest historians for the Christian community in the United States that we have. But more importantly, did you hear him? He and Brent Strawn from the past couple of weeks, they almost sound like they're reading from the same book. And I wonder if they're not. Because did you hear Grant talk about we're being formed? All that we do in our Christian faith and in our community, he talked about Wesley's tradition. That's really Wesley's way of talking about history and our history. And through the biblical text and through our very community. I don't know about you, but I am so glad that I've been formed by the traditions, the history, the scriptures. And for many like you, who have poured themselves into me, that have shaped and formed me. So when the trials and the negativity, that even comes to preachers and pastors and theologians, come, it's not going to push me off to the side. So yet I will praise the Lord. And what you're going through, I hope that this time with these great people of faith will teach you.
Hear these words. Dear friends, let us love one another because love comes from God. Whoever loves is a child of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, for God is love. And God showed his love for us by sending his only Son into the world so that we might have life through him. This is what love is. It's not that we've loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the means by which our sins would be forgiven. I don't know about you, but I certainly know that's something I can't do on my own. Dear friends, if this is how God loved us, then we should love one another. No one has ever seen God. But if we love one another, God lives in union with us, and his love is made perfect in us.
My wife April and I are having dinner with a bunch of my old bike racing friends, and we are celebrating the birthday of one of our friends. And we're talking about some things as you do at dinner parties. And one of them makes the comment, hey, I saw your station wagon when you pulled up. And I was like, well, yeah, we're parents now and car seats and everything. And you know, going to church. And he goes, church? And I was like, yeah, what church do you go to? I was like, well, we're going to a Methodist church in Cary. And he went, Methodist? All you people think you need to get into heaven is a covered dish. We all laughed, of course. And the idea was pretty funny. All we needed for heaven is a covered dish to gain entry. Man, if it were that easy, right? But I've been thinking about that in a different way, especially now after hearing Dr. Wacker's story about receiving from someone who loved him. Yeah, the kingdom of God, the key to the gates, maybe it is a covered dish. Maybe it is a casserole. Maybe that's the way that we stop using words to demand others to understand who our Lord and Savior is, and we start showing them who Jesus is. I mean, who's going to listen? If we only use words to talk about our faith, this is who we're going to be talking to. And I got to tell you, it's kind of boring. I don't feel like I'm doing anything. But if I talk about who Jesus is, and then I live out my life in a way that looks like I follow Jesus, maybe that is a great way to be a true disciple of Jesus Christ, a follower. Thank you for worshiping at White Plains.
for that.
Yeah, that's you right. could swim over there.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, all right. Because right.
that's and what then, and my first job was at UNC.
Yeah.
And I was there 15 years. And then after 15 years, I started looking for a better basketball team.
Oh.
And so that, then.
That would have been hard to do, though.
Yeah, well, sometimes. Yeah. Sorry, you know, sometimes it's easy. Yeah, some years. Yeah.
Yeah.
And so one year, it was a very easy choice. I just walked across the highway.
Yeah.
And yeah, I'm teasing.